coffee and I need to call it to like dwell on the rest of it.
You're fine.
Since there's no injury, is that time now?
I wonder, I believe there will be bell ringing.
Should we,
maybe just introduce it this time?
Okay.
This one time, just to be like, we're starting now.
Okay. Good morning to Theater Parker Church. And now we will have the Jennifers ringing our bell. Good morning. Welcome to Theodore Parker Unitarian Universalist Church. My name is Ruth Kahn, and I've been here since 2016. It will be 10 years in 2 years. Unbelievable. And I'm thrilled, I'm always thrilled to be here. As we enter into worship, we bring with us all of the sorrows and joys of our week. And we know that we are held in loving community. Here, we are reminded that we are part of something larger than ourselves. Here, we seek to counter oppression, to work for healing and justice in a bruised and broken world, and this week, for workers and mothers everywhere. Here, we invite all of you to bring your perspectives, your beliefs and doubts, and all that is unique and wondrous about you to our service. In the spirit of love, all are welcome here. For those of you joining us in person, a few things you may want to know. Our congregation is mask optional, and if you'd like to be seated in an area where others are also wearing a mask, the section by the windows on your right are this section that's reserved for people wearing masks. You can use the QR codes at either entrance or in your pews to pull up the order of service on your phone, or take one of the large print copies available at either entrance. If you would like to have a joy or concern shared with the congregation today during our meditation and prayer, we invite you to fill out a card anytime before our meditation hymn on the table to your right. You may also light a silent candle of joy or concern anytime during our worship service, or use the space in the far back corner for private reflection during the service. People of all ages are welcome to move about in the sanctuary as they need to, or to make themselves comfortable in the cozy zone in the front part of the first pew. Children's programming for elementary school age kids is happening today. During the service, our child care provider, Shay, is available to be with nursery-aged children in the nursery located in our parish hall. Many thanks to Mary Beth, who is our camera point person today, and to Tom, who is our Zoom usher. If you're new to Theodore Parker Church or are visiting today, we'd love to stay in touch. You're invited to fill out a connection card, which will give you an opportunity to sign up for our weekly updates and help us to welcome you. A link to the connection card will be in the chat, as well as our contact information. Those joining us here in the sanctuary are encouraged to fill in the contact card you'll find in your pews within the welcome brochure. We'd like to take a moment to greet one another here and off-site as one congregation. For those of you on Zoom, putting your video on for this time helps us connect. Sanctuary people, please turn and wave. The camera is under the clock in the back. Offsite people can see you on their screens. Now, Mary Beth, would you please put our sanctuary screen in gallery view? Folks in the sanctuary, you can see our offsite congregation better. We ask those of you off-site to wave back. As we continue to greet one another, if online, you may post a hello in the chat. If you are physically in the sanctuary, we invite you to greet one another and say good morning. And please ask for consent before offering a hug or a handshake. Please greet one another. Following the greeting, I will ring a chime to ask you to be seated, and the prelude will begin. I will introduce you. I will introduce you. Okay. As you return to your seats, Yukiko will be playing portions of the French Suite No. 6 by Johann Sebastian Bach for us this morning.
Good morning. You all bring joy to Sunday morning really, really well. Good job. Our opening words this morning are by, I believe, last year's National Poet Laureate, Joy Harjo, entitled Once the World Was Perfect. Once the world was perfect, and we were happy in that world, and then we took it for granted Discontent began as a small rumble in the earthly mind, then doubt pushed through with its spiked head. And once doubt ruptured the web, all manner of demon thoughts jumped through. We destroyed the world we had been given for inspiration and for life. Each stone of jealousy, each stone of fear, of greed, of envy, of hatred, put out the light. And no one was without a stone in their hand. And there we were, right back where we had started. We were bumping into each other in the dark. And we had no place to live because we didn't know how to live with each other. Then one of the stumbling ones took pity on another and shared a blanket. And a spark of kindness made a light. The light made an opening in the darkness. Everyone worked together to make a ladder. A Wind Clan person climbed out of the first world into the next world. And then all the other clans and the children of those clans, their children and their children, all the way through time to now, into this morning light to you. Please rise in body or spirit and join me in hymn number 38, Morning Has Broken.
Morning has broken like the first morning. Blackbird has spoken like the first bird. Praise for the singing, praise for the morning, praise for the springing, fresh from the world. Sweetness the rains blew, falls from night heaven, like the first dewfall on the first grass. Praise for the sweetness of the wet garden, sprung in completeness where God's feet pass. Mine is the sunlight, mine is the morning, born of the one light, Eden's all play. Praise with elation, praise every morning, God's recreation of the new day.
I'd love for you to join me in saying our chalice-lighting words. They, I think, will not be up on the screen because we're having some tech issues with our slideshow, but if you've been around long enough, you may just remember them by heart. Ruth, do you mind lighting our chalice? Wonderful. Please say them with me as much as you can remember. Love is the spirit of this church, and service is its prayer. This is our great covenant, to dwell together in peace, to seek the truth in love, and to help one another. El amor es el espíritu de esta iglesia y el servicio es nuestra oración. Esta es nuestra gran promesa, vivir juntos en paz, buscar la verdad con amor y ayudarnos los unos a los otros.
Good morning. I'm realizing, well, my name is Rose. It's so good to be with you all. I'm this congregation's religious educator. I have a story to share with you all this morning, and this morning I picked out a storybook that I was hoping we'd be able to have the slides for. I'm actually gonna scoot myself back up here and see if I might be able to share it.
While I could just read the words, it's a little better with the images. I might be able to manage this. Just a second. I'm so sorry, y'all. This is probably not going to work. The story I had to share, which may or may not come up on the screen, is called I Am Love by Susan Verde. Might be familiar. I'll try reading it out without the images, and I think it may feel like a bit more of a meditation without the pictures, but we'll see. Okay, I Am Love, A Book of Compassion by Susan Verde. When I see someone going through a storm of hurt and unfairness, anger and sadness, when the sun disappears and the skies grow dark, and I see there is fear, I ask myself, what can I do to help let the light back in? I put my hand on my heart and listen, and that is where I find the answer. I have compassion. I act with tenderness. I am love. I can listen and not say a word. I can be there. Love is being present. I can hug and hold and say, everything will be all right. Love is comfort. I can speak softly, choose my words and actions carefully. Love is gentle. I can give thanks for all that I have and am able to share. Love is gratitude. I can keep my mind and body safe and healthy. Love is taking care of me. I can express what's important to me. Love is creative. I can know that no one is perfect. Love is understanding. I can do my best to make things better when something is wrong. Love is effort. I can celebrate those I've loved before. Love is remembering. I can find goodness in a kind word, a helping hand, or a shared smile. Love is tiny gestures. I can breathe in the air that the whole world shares and know all creatures are made from the very same stardust. Love is connection. When the clouds roll in for others and for me, I know now there is something I can do. I can let my heart lead the way. I am love. You are love. We are love. And with love, we will weather the storm and light up the sky together. Thank you all very much. So glad I got to share that story in word, if not in image. I think all of our kids today are off celebrating Mother's Day. So as we continue to honor that day in our own way throughout the service, I'll stay with you all this morning.
Please join us in hymn number 95, There Is More Love Somewhere.
gonna keep on till I find it. There is more love somewhere. There is more hope somewhere. There is more hope somewhere. Gonna keep on till I find it. There is more hope somewhere. There is more peace somewhere. There is more peace somewhere. I'm gonna keep on till I find it. There is more peace somewhere. There is more joy somewhere. There is more joy somewhere. I'm gonna keep on till I find it. There is more joy somewhere.
Robin, that's impressive. As we prepare ourselves for a time of meditation and prayer, I invite you to center into this moment here and now, to feel the earth's gravity holding you, to take some nurturing breaths, and to give yourself over to this time of stillness. If you're here in the sanctuary and would like to include a joy or concern, you can fill out a prayer card during the centering hymn. And if you're on Zoom and you wish to share a joy or concern during this time, I invite you to type that into the chat now. And now I realize we were supposed to do the song first to give you guys. So can we give them a little bit of musical space to think about joys and concerns? Our joys and concerns this morning include a sorrow for those broken from family relationships. To the newest mom at Theodore Parker Church, Rev Heather, I did not know this. Congratulations. Maybe a round of applause. Yeah. Mary Boyle offers a sorrow for the mothers in Israel and Gaza. Jen offers a joy to all those who mother each other and the planet, and a sorrow that Mary Robeson would love a short visit at her home on Mondays, Wednesdays, and Fridays. And I believe there's a couple in the chat. Thomas Cadill offers a candle of concern that his brother-in-law, Bob, just underwent brain surgery after being diagnosed with a brain tumor. He's holding him and his sister's family in their thoughts this morning, as are we. And Kathy Ware shares that she's in New Hampshire holding vigil while her favorite aunt is in hospice care at home. They are on day 9. Please lift her Aunt Joanne up in your thoughts. I'm gonna light one more candle for all those joys and sorrows left in our hearts. And because it's Mother's Day, I want to pause here to acknowledge that. There's an invitation at the end of this reading, and I'm going to share a reading first, but there's an invitation at the end to name those who mothered you. And I want you to think about this widely defined. Who parented you? Who loved you? Who helped create you into the fullness of the being that you find yourself now? And you might wonder, do I mean someone who has to be alive, or am I including those who have passed? Again, you have your own interpretations. I leave it up to your discretion. From where we have come, this breath, these fingers, a heart that opens and closes, we come into consciousness in the middle of the story. The world and its vast life reaches for far before we knew and grasps at a future that we don't yet see. And here we are, living these days. Whatever acts of chance brought us to this birth, whatever happenstance laid this particular path for our lives, in these moments of calm and stillness, let our hearts open in gratitude for the gifts that can be found along the way, for love given freely, for the peace of this morning, for the warm colors of the sun, for the grace of beautiful companions, and for moments of ongoing birth. As our hearts are renewed for those who have offered and given us the gift of mothering, we also recognize that sometimes grief comes with such memories. So we open a compassion for broken hearts, people who have lost mothers, mothers who cannot love us the way we needed, and especially those longing for children never met. So in the quiet moments that follow, I invite you to speak aloud the names of those who have given you life, those who have companioned you, and those you hold in your heart this day. And I'll start. Bev, Jeannie, please follow.
Sally, Lord, Lois, and Alaska Town.
Thank you.
Generosity is the spiritual practice of our Unitarian Universalist congregation. This month, our theme of pluralism honors our sacred diversity. We respect different experiences, cultures, and theologies, and strive to accept and acknowledge our differences, exploring and learning from many perspectives. Each of us is blessed. We gain by finding more in what others offer. We give to remember that we are part of something bigger than ourselves. We are a vast rainbow bursting into view. We give with gratitude for all that we have been given and with the faith that together we have more than enough. Links to donate will be in the chat, or if you can take a moment writing out a check and sending it to the church. Ushers will be coming around the sanctuary to collect an offering, and from those in the pews who wish to donate as you are able. As Yukiko shares another excerpt from the French Suite by Bach, an offering to sustain this congregation of memory and hope will be gratefully received. Thank you.
So good morning again. It's good to be back with you. I do want to offer you some Mother's Day greetings because I know that for some this is not the easiest day. Perhaps your mom has passed, or it was a fraught relationship, or maybe a distant one. Maybe you're experiencing emotional distance from your child, or maybe you never got to parent. Maybe that desire to parent, regardless of gender identity, is still in you. And maybe this is a gorgeous day for you, filled with joy at this child or children that you've brought into the world. Perhaps they now have children of their own and you get that perfect job of grandparenting. Maybe you fostered or adopted, or you are fostered or adopted. Or you're part of a created family, one based not on genetics, but solely on a choice to be a family. Maybe you never had kids, but you work with them, and the hundreds or thousands of them you've encountered in your lifetime feel like your own. You get the idea. Wherever you find yourself, whoever you are, know that you are loved and valued, seen and held here this day. There's a show I used to watch, maybe you did too, called Call the Midwife. And I think it does an exceptionally good job at naming both the holy and the drudgery of mothering. The show was based on British sisters, nuns mostly, whose calling and purpose, as far as the church was concerned, was to bring babies into this world. And I'll admit that watching these nuns who were midwives helping woman after woman in the most magical and I think terrifying process of bringing babies into this world, it completely entranced and drew me in time after time after time. How amazing that the human body can literally grow a new human. How amazing is that? And that somehow magically, if not easily, bring that baby into the world. But that's not the only reason I love this show. What pulled at my heart every time was the fearlessness of naming the context of these births. Women in terrible situations, forced to have children they didn't want or couldn't afford. People in abusive relationships, trying to protect or escape with their children. Mothers living in terribly unsanitary and unsafe conditions, unable to protect their children from disease and worse. Mothers in safe situations who nonetheless experienced the trauma of childbirth or maybe postpartum depression, or maybe feeling unable to care, to be able to care for a child born disabled. Again, you get the idea. The show, it didn't shy away from the big questions, the important questions. And eventually, I think 6 or 7 or 8 seasons in, the topic of abortion, of a person's right to choose, finally came up. First, tentatively, and then with a sense of the deep emotional and spiritual reckoning that people of faith have to tackle with, both as a community and as individuals, around reproductive rights. The question of whether a child is wanted, whether it is good for the parent to have that child, that finally became the center of the story, appropriately so. Which led, as we know in our own lives, to the eventual fight for an achievement of people who bear children to have rights over their own bodies, to make their own decisions around reproduction. And I'm guessing that some of you here might have been involved in Roe v. Wade in the fight for that, but certainly at some arc in your lives, I'm sure most of you have fought around reproductive rights. And I have no doubt that 50 years later, after the Dobbs decision, that most of you are active in fighting to protect the rights that are left. And that's my focus today, even though it takes me a little while to get here. It's on the power of community. It's about what can be done, what is done when we are told we're not able to accomplish something. In that show, as in real life, laws and repression don't stop abortions, but instead push those activities out of the public eye. They still happen. At least for those able to travel and those able to afford it. And this is what is always true around humans. The human desire to protect one another, to love beyond simple boundaries, is most evident during the times when we are most subject to control. It's like with a child. You have a small child and you tell him, no, you can't do that. And it's like telling them, please only do that. You know, the more you push, the more the pushback happens. And we're good. We're really, really good at showing up for each other in these times. Which brings me to International Workers' Day. It started in 1889, sorry, and it celebrated the Haymarket riot that had happened 3 years earlier. Anyone know the Haymarket riot? All right. Haymarket riot, the conditions, the working conditions were so bad. So many people were dying and getting maimed in factories that these people who had everything to lose rioted. They rioted for better conditions. They were working to keep food on the table and their children alive. They were working with poverty and disease. And these people who could not afford to lose their jobs, could not afford to lose what minimal safety they had, did exactly that, forcing a shift to safer working conditions, setting the stage for what would become modern-day unions, for safety laws, because they understood what we understand, that it is our job to care for each other. I recall a bumper sticker when I was growing up, for those of you that remember bumper stickers. And it said, "Do you enjoy the weekend? Thank a union." And it was a very non-subtle reminder of the rights fought for and won by those we never knew. From safety to sanitation, from emissions to clean water, from midwifery to birth control, rights have been organized for and won by individuals who often don't benefit in their lifetime, but who saw the need to change the world and make it better for the generations that follow. And this show called The Midwife, it wasn't just about babies, right? It was about structural poverty, of classism and racism, of gaining rights for immigrants and LGBTQ individuals. I must admit, I was super happy when they finally had a lesbian character. And they did it well. It reminded that every baby is born into a context, maybe a safe and warm bed, replete with everything they need. Or maybe in a large family in terrible housing without enough food or care. And the show didn't evangelize, really. It just highlighted the changes that could be made. It showed what happens when people show up for each other, and especially when that care is extended to the most vulnerable of beings. And thus the invitation to celebrate Mother's Day this year, not because this day is easy or perfect for many of us, but because it evokes something in humanity that touches us at our core and invites us to work for a greater good, toward the betterment of others, others we know intimately, maybe as family, and maybe people we don't know at all. That's the connective tissue here, that we are acting in ways that care for each other. That brings out the best in us. And when we recognize that that change won't occur maybe in our lifetimes, but we do it anyways, we are enriched. And let me be clear, let me come back to the notion of reproductive freedom, right? We know it's the individual who decides when and how new lives are brought into this world. There is no law we're going to accept, no way we're going to allow ourselves or future generations to go back to a time when the choice to have a child or not was very much not our own. We're not going to stop. So on this day of mothering, on this day when we weave love in different ways, of this day of a love so strong it holds us all, may we remember all of those who worked for our life, and may we be grateful for all the way that we work towards future generations. Blessed be. Please rise in body or spirit and join me in hymn number 121, "We'll Build a Land."
We'll build a land where we bind up the broken, We'll build a land where the captives go free, where the oil of gladness dissolves, O morning. Oh, we'll build a promised land, land that can be. Come build a land where we're sisters and brothers, anointed by God, may then create peace. The justice roll down like waters, and peace like an ever-flowing stream. We'll build a land where we bring the good tidings to all the afflicted and all those who mourn, and we'll give them garlands instead of ashes. Oh, we'll build a land where peace is born. Come build a land where sisters and brothers, anointed by God, may then greet peace. Justice roll down like waters, and peace like an ever-flowing stream. We'll build a land building up ancient cities, raising up devastations from old, restoring ruins of generations. Oh, we'll build a land of people so bold. Come build a land where sisters and brothers, anointed by God, may then create peace. Where justice roll down like waters, and peace like an ever-flowing stream. Come build a land where the mantles of praises resound from spirits once patient, once weak, where cokes of righteousness stand her people. Oh, come build a land, my people we seek. Come build a land where sisters and brothers, anointed by God, may then create peace. The justice roll down like waters, and peace like an ever-flowing stream.
So we have a couple of announcements. So please, of course, join us for coffee hour in the parish hall or on breakout rooms on Zoom. There will be a plant sale next Saturday, the 18th, from 10 to 2 in the parish hall. Plant donations and volunteers are still welcome. Please see the church newsletter and the plant sale flyer for more details, or talk to Jennifer Buchwald. There are upcoming fundraisers for Palestine and the Mother's Day Walk for Peace with TPC participation organized by the Justice Allies. See Deb Ferenz at coffee hour for more information. And on Monday, May 20th at 6:30, Diana's List will hold a public book discussion of tracing homelands, Israel, Palestine, and claims of belonging with Linda Dittmar, the author of this unique and timely memoir. See the TPC events page for pre-registration information. And let me just say, if I lived closer, I would be here. On June 29th, TPC will participate in the 11th annual celebration of grassroots organizing at the First Parish Dorchester Picnic. Please talk with Dave Harrington or Kevin Murray for details. And a late breaking announcement, there are some Tracing Homelands books to borrow next to Theodore Parker. Oh, next to Theodore Parker. It's like, where is Theodore Parker? Thank you for the laughter. Our closing words today are from the Reverend Barbara Peskin, because of those who came before. Because of those who came before, we are. In spite of their failings, we believe. Because of and in spite of the horizons of their vision, we too dream. Let us go remembering to praise, to live in the moment, to love mightily, and to bow to the mystery.
Thank you.